When it comes to surgery, you know, you mentioned the side effects of those. Are those going to happen to every man who has surgery? What is the percentage likelihood of a man receiving those side effects?
There are some men that will come through surgery relatively unscathed. A certain percentage of men will have the operation, of course, right after the surgery. They have problems, but they slowly heal over a period of weeks or months. And then other than the fact that there's a, dry orgasms, the prostate makes semen, and so they don't create any semen when they have an orgasm, they could emerge relatively normal. Unfortunately, when you query people with surveys after surgery, say wait a year or wait 2 years until they have time to heal, only about 5% of men say that it's like it was before. And that's a pretty dreadful statistic. If you compare that to radiation statistics, as many as half of men will describe their sex life, their urinary function, as identical to what it was like before treatment. So radiation is not perfect, but the outcomes are certainly a lot better than they are with surgery.
So that's actually interesting that you bring that up, because I think a lot of men, when it comes to surgery versus radiation, they talk about, you know, with surgery, you know the side effects right away, but with radiation, you don't, because it can be a year or two out. But in reality, with 95% of men kind of getting these results, it seems like surgery is not really the best case, considering radiation, even if it is 1 or 2 years out, the percentage likelihood seems far less of having side effects. So can you talk about what is that percentage likelihood?
So yeah, of course, you have to compare same age patients. Patients who have surgery oftentimes are younger, and therefore they're going to have better outcomes because of their youthfulness. But if you compare same age patients, and you also have to compare the quality of the surgeon and the quality of the radiation therapist. So let's assume the very highest quality of surgeon and the very highest quality of radiation therapist. Numbers degenerate quickly with older people and with poor quality doctors. But if you have a relatively young person, say around 55 or 60, who's got good pre-treatment functioning, goes to a superstar surgeon, world famous surgeon, or a really qualified radiation therapist, the incidence of leaking urine afterwards for these people is going to be probably around 5%, 5 to 7% with surgery, and it'll be less than 1% with radiation. As many as 20% of men ejaculate urine afterwards, unfortunately. This isn't talked about too much. It's a phenomenon called climacteria. Not a whole lot you can do about it, and that doesn't occur with radiation. It does occur with surgery. The problems with impotence are probably twice as high with surgery as they are with radiation. You're looking at maybe 20-25% incidence of erectile dysfunction that doesn't respond to Viagra in the radiation group, and more like 35-40% risk of erectile dysfunction in the surgery group. And it's just, on pretty much every metric, the outcomes with radiation are better. There are sometimes issues raised about, well, if treatment fails, you can do radiation after surgery, but you can't do surgery after radiation. And this was an argument that was valid 15, 20 years ago when the radiation was really rotten and a lot of men were relapsing. Modern radiation, relapses within the prostate itself are incredibly rare. And if they happen, I almost never see that, but if they happen, then we do something like laser or cryotherapy or HIFU. We don't worry about doing surgery. So it's hard to find an argument to do surgery if you could know that you were going to be the, say, 1 out of 3 men that has a really nice result. Surgery would be fine, but it's a crapshoot. You don't really know if you're going to be in the good one-third or the bad two-thirds.
So, you know, you mentioned climacteria and these different side effects, and you said that a lot of times there's not much they can do. So is this on a permanent basis? Does it ever go away, or is it just for the rest of the man's life? I mean, a 65-year-old getting something like ejaculating urine for the rest of his life, let's say he, you know, lives another 30, you know, years, that's awful.
It is. I don't know why it isn't talked about more. Another thing that doesn't come up in these discussions is the recovery period after surgery. All the men are impotent, and then they slowly recover over a period of 3, 6, 9, 12, 15 months. During that time, the absence of getting erections can cause permanent atrophy. And so anyone that's contemplating doing surgery should have a discussion before the operation with his urologist about arranging to get penile injections with the prostaglandins to create artificial erections while you're waiting for the recovery period so that atrophy doesn't set in. And this conversation never seems to come up, I think, because the surgeons know if you start describing to men that you're going to have to take injections in your penis right after the operation, that you may need to do that for 3, 6, 12 months to give yourself the best chance to recover, who would do surgery? But you know, it seems like the whole idea is to try and slide people into surgery as quickly as possible. And as you know, I'm not a radiation doctor nor a surgeon. I just see this lack of careful analysis that leads people into making quick decisions for surgery when I think if they were better informed, they'd be picking some form of radiation.
When in regards to using, making sure the penis has use after, you know, surgery, would that be the same in radiation?
People who undergo radiation, unless they're getting hormone treatment with the radiation, are not going to experience immediate problems with erectile dysfunction. A percentage of men will develop erectile dysfunction over a period of 1 to 2 years after the radiation. And at that point, people try Viagra and Cialis. If that's ineffective, then the fallback position is injection therapy. Obviously not a very desirable thing, but only a small percentage of men are going to end up in that situation when they have radiation.
So I know a major fear I hear quite often is the concept of radiation burns to the rectum. So first of all, can you describe that? And then also talk about the advent of SpaceOAR, because I think that it's being, you know, used across the nation now, and it's obviously helped many men.
Yeah, that was one of the scary things that would happen in skillfully administered radiation. Perhaps less than 5% would develop non-healing wounds in their rectum. Pretty dreadful problem called proctitis. That's essentially been eliminated with the advent of a gel that they can squirt between the prostate and the rectal wall, pushing it out of the radiation field. So I consider that routine now, and so problems with rectal burns have been essentially eliminated.
Hey everyone, it's Alex and Hunter from the PCRI. He has his own Instagram now, Sir Hunter the Dow, so go ahead and check him out for prostate cancer information and men's health. Huh, do you like it? Yes, say come follow me. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. We come out with new prostate cancer videos every week.